Welcome to Bethel World Outreach Church. Our values are devotion, diversity, and discipleship. Devotion through honoring God by trusting His Word, praying, and worshiping together. Diversity by embracing God's heart for every nation. And discipleship by helping others follow Jesus. So join us as we're reaching a city to touch the world.
I have spent some of my life recently going through transformation. One of the most stressful times in my life is Saturday night when I'm trying to discover what actually fits that I can wear. Last night, I put on some clothes from high school. They did not fit. But you know how it is. You just want to know sometimes. I'm still, but it's not true, you know. How often do we try to wear something that used to fit but don't fit anymore? Every one of us is responsible to make that transition and grow up, shed the old and embrace the new. But sometimes that's very difficult. It's very difficult. In fact, when I think about society, we have gotten into a thing where we no longer can kind of discern what we really are, what we really have, and what we really can do based on our own identification and our own personification of what we say we are. In other words, you can say you're a believer, but does your life line up with a believing lifestyle? That becomes a question. So are you counterfeit, or do you not even know? You know, if you took a counterfeit $100 bill, there is a test you can give it. You can hold it up and, you know, look in the light. You can look at the watermark. It's like 10 things to figure out if it's authentic. I believe we need to test the authenticity, or we need a litmus. We need some type of test to figure out what we really are. Because you can confess something so long and live a life opposite of your confession and get lost and believe that you are something that you're not. It's like the scripture said, not everybody that says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter in. So you can have the right statements, but not the right life that goes with it. Now, as we transition, we're going to see in Colossians that there's a little test in there that you can give to see exactly where you stand. And if you're embracing some of your old qualities in the old man and devaluing your currency, because that's what you do. If you live the old life when God is giving you the new life, what happens is your life becomes devalued. When other people look at it, they can no longer distinguish. Because I think I'm tired. I am a little tired of prominent people claiming Christianity in one moment with one breath, and then in the next breath using profanity and loose living. That's not who our God is. That's not who believers are. But we've got to attack. We've got to go after what's making this confusion? Let's look at the test. So let's go to Colossians 3. We're going to be in the Bible quite a bit. And let's see what the Lord has to say about it. I do want to give a shout out to the next generation. And though sometimes I don't take the time, and I don't know if he can hear me, to really thank my son. He's not just a youth minister of church, but son, it's tough growing up in my house. You know, just, you know, it could be tough, but I'm really impressed with where the young people are and what they're doing. So I'll give you one more shout out just before we get into the Word of God. Let's start at the fifth verse. It starts out pretty punchy, pretty powerful. Put to death, therefore, what is earthly in you. That means there can be some stuff in you that's more synonymous with sensuality and earthly things and things that are not consistent with God, and you got to put them to death. It's not saying that you should, you know, kind of slowly put them to sleep. Put them to death. Kill them. There's stuff in my life that just needs to die. And when those things die, I start looking like him instead of looking like the world. Let me give an example of some of the first things that said to die in verse 5. It says, sexual immorality needs to die. Impurity needs to die. Pastor, evil desires needs to die. Covetousness, which is idolatry, needs to die. Sexual perversion in our generation, in our world right now, needs to die. We have got to protest everything being sexualized and our next generation being introduced to impurity and everything that is sensual. See, he's not asking us to try on the clothes of the old man. He's telling us to burn it, to put it to death, and to get it out of our life. I want sexual immorality out of our life. It should not be it should not be named among us. I'm not saying there won't be temptation. I'm not saying that there's not hard times. But how does he tell you to deal with it? Kill it. Put it to death. Put it on a cross and burn it up so that you can prove I'm authentic. I'm real. I'm valuable. And I'm not going to be devalued. Immorality is not going to define the next generation. I believe purity can. I told that story not to be boastful about God preserving me, but so the next generation can know God can keep you. God can keep you. Just kill it. Kill it. The grace of God teaches us to say no. I don't do that. Don't let some guy boo up on you. Girls, it's way too early. They don't even know how to treat you right. You know, it's way too early. You in high school, booing up, stop. No. Well, my mama said it's okay. I know, but I'm going to just help everybody out right now. Okay, no. I know young guys. They know them. They not ready. You think the guy you got is special. No. Says, put it to death. Then it says, verse 8, but now you also must put them all away. Anger, wrath, malice, slander, and obscene talk from your mouth. You've got to put it to death. You know, so I usually say it like this. Anger put unchecked turns to malice. And malice unchecked turns to wrath, and wrath unchecked turns to a slanderous disposition and lifestyle. It's amazing to me that believers on social media and believers on the news can be slanderous and abusive to other people, and that's because the old man is alive and they're devaluing their currency. Who told you it was okay to express your anger in a spiteful, hurtful, wrathful way? You can't. It says the old man, you know what the old man likes to do? Lie. Do not lie. You know people lie. This just needs to be said. Pastor Dave needs to be said. A little white lie is a lie. That's a lie. Exaggeration. It's a lie. It's a deception. This is not consistent with the life and lifestyle of a believer. Why is it important? Because these things cannot exist in the church. You can have a mistake. You can have a little bit of a breakdown that you can confess and repent and forsake. But this is not your identity. You put the old guy to bed, to rest, to death. He can't function in your life anymore. Do not lie, verse 9, to one another, seeing that you have put off the old self with its practices. And you have put on the new self, which is being renewed in knowledge after the image of the Creator. In other words, you have forsaken your high school outfits. They don't fit you anymore. Lying doesn't fit you. Immorality doesn't fit you. Anger and wrath, it doesn't fit you. It has no place in my life. It doesn't need to, that's not what I need to have on.
Come on, say it.
Because it's oxymoronic to have somebody who names Christ as their Lord and yet they're still vengeful. It's going to come a time in this year where the world is going to tell you that you can be hateful and spiteful, that you can pick sides and you can be vengeful and you can just go after somebody with vitriol, and that is righteous anger. No. We know how to fight, but we fight fair. Hate is not our weapon. Slander is not our weapon. You don't say to politicians you don't like, yo, no good, senile, you know, stop. And don't like posts of people who do that. Stop. Other people can see what you like. Oh, yeah, I like. No, stop. You're devaluing your currency. Let's go to verse 12. In verse 12, if we've talked about what you shouldn't have on, let us look at what you should have on. If you shouldn't be wearing your old high school clothes because the jacket wouldn't close, then which one should you wear? Put on then, as God's chosen, holy, and beloved, compassionate hearts, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience. You should be putting on stuff that looks like him. You should be putting on. The reason you need to have on kindness, because he's kind. The reason you need to have on compassion, because he's compassionate. Let's just stop and talk about compassion. Compassion is synonymous with mercy. Mercy is when you don't get what you do deserve. Are you willing to be merciful? Are you willing to be gentle? Are you willing to be kind? The Bible said when he said his yoke is easy, that word easy means kind. He is kind. Are you kind? Y'all didn't say amen, so let's just stay there for a minute. I know what it's like to put on the clothes of the old man. I was in Chick-fil-A line yesterday. Jason was on this side, and they were messing up my order. I get impatient. I'm not patient. I'm not humble. You know, and it's, you know, the Chick-fil-A kids is nice, and I'm a pastor, and I'm coming through. Hey! I said a large ice cream cone. That ain't all. And I can hear Jason. No, that. Kind. And I just went home with that little stubby ice cream cone. It was wrong. And he said, it's good. It's fine. It wasn't fine, son. But it was kind for us not to get on the little Chick-fil-A guy. Put it on. What is on you? Because if you go out in this world with the old man on you, you're going to be vengeful and hateful and stubborn and rude, and you're going to feel self-righteous. Put it on, compassion. That means when people interact with you, they feel the mercy. They feel the kindness. They feel the patience. Now, this next particular verse makes it even more personal. And I want you to understand, when you put on Christ, he is giving you the virtues and the qualities that you need to have great interaction with others. Other people need these things from you. And look, it says in verse 13, bearing with one another. And if anyone has a complaint against another, forgive each other as the Lord has forgiven you. So you must forgive. Now, somebody told me recently, they don't really like the messages on forgiveness because there's always somebody that comes to your heart you need to forgive. Said if you have a complaint against other, you know, again, I'm just going to talk about myself when I get into the old man, and I'm complaining. I know I'm an old man, just complaining. Everything's a problem. And it's always somebody else's fault. And when I talk, it's always legitimate. Forgiving someone is releasing them from the penalty they do deserve. I'm not saying they didn't do you wrong. I'm just saying God said let them off the hook. Now, you might not want to let them off the hook because they need to pay. But the scriptures say, vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. I will repay. He said, hold your peace. Let the Lord fight your battle. When somebody do something wrong to you, God got that. That's why he said, pray for them to despitefully use you and persecute you. He's trying to teach us with the new man how to deal with each other. He said, forgive because I've forgiven you. Now, this is the hard part for self-righteous people like myself. I ain't did nothing. That's what you do when somebody need to, they did something, you got a complaint. I ain't did nothing. I'm fine. I don't know what's wrong with them. Christ forgave you, James Lowe. Christ blotted out your transgressions. He moved your sins as far as the east is from the west. He remembers them no more. He doesn't deal with you according to them. How is it in my human relationships that I'm so familiar with what you did against me that I start the relationship angry? Because you know what you did. We want people to pay. And God wants to release us from the penalty. We are most like God when we put the clothes on forgiveness. That's why you can't enter into this world's battle with each other. You have to forgive. They just messed up the economy. Forgive. They messed up the world. Just forgive. If you don't forgive, you're going to get critical. If you get critical, you're going to get bitter. And if you get bitter, you're going to feel justified to lash out. Don't do it. Does that mean that there's not wrong in the world? No, it's wrong in the world, but there's a right way to deal with it when you're clothed and you got the right clothes on. See, when you see a priest, Pastor Bryson, when you see a priest or a man of God, a clergy with a collar on, there's a certain expectation of that person because of the clothes that they're wearing that they're all right. When you see a police officer, there's a certain expectation of what you can get. When you see a Christ follower, let me go. Thank you. When you see a Christ follower, there's a certain expectation that should go along with that. That next, put the verse up. I think the next verse says, bear with one another. Is that 13? Bearing with one another. Bearing. I want people, when I do something wrong, to give me a break. But why am I mad when people who did something wrong to me get a break? I want a break. Oh, man, I didn't mean it. I want them to know I was having a bad day. I was having a bad time. I ate some bad food. It just, you know, it wasn't really my best day. Let's just forget about it. But do something wrong to me. And it feels like this has been the season in my own life when people are doing something wrong to me and God's immediate thing, just forgive them. Just let them go. Just let them go. I was just talking to my son, James, who was ministering to me, and I was telling him, that so-and-so did something wrong. He said, I know, but God ain't going to let you have a reaction to that, so just let it go. Thank you for ministering to me in a way that I didn't want to be ministered to. Thank you. And the thing is, you're mad sometimes when information comes from a place you don't want to receive it. Yeah, I know that, but still. Bear with one another. Let's go on to verse 14. And above all these, put on love. Look, he's still getting us to put the right clothes on. When people come around you, they should feel love permeating from you because God is love and love is God. It should just be dripping off of you. Just love. Love that's believing all things and hoping all things. Love that is just reshaping the world that we live in. He says this love binds everything together in perfect harmony. So stop thinking that the world and the people who wear the old clothes are winning.
Come on, say that.
Your love binds everybody together. Your ministry of reconciliation binds everybody together. The love you share pulls it all together. And let the peace of God. Now, this is going to be interesting. He said, and let the peace of God rule in your heart, to which indeed you are called in one body, and be thankful. I just want to stop. Let the peace reign. That means when it says let, that means this is something through the choice of your will you have to allow to happen because you have embraced the new nature. Let peace reign. Maybe if you're not peaceful or at peace, you're not letting peace reign. You've told God, I was explaining to some young people today, you told God that this is the narrow space that you can commune and communicate with me. But you need to let the space that God has in your life expand to envelop you. Let peace reign. Why are you not in peace about the economy? Believers don't live in the world's economy.
Say that, Pastor James.
Say that. Let me talk to you. Because y'all might be broke and I got to get y'all out of Brooklyn. Believers don't live based on the world's economy. We know how to give, and then it's giving back, pressed down, shaking together, running over. Now, we don't give to get, but it is your generous spirit that causes things, generosity, to come back to you. There's all these benefits that we have in Christ. Let peace reign. Now, the other let comes in the very next verse, verse 16. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. What's dwelling in you? Drake and Kendrick's battle can't dwell in you. I'm just let that for the next generation. Don't fully know who they are, but I know that's that they're people out there fighting right now. Don't, you gotta let the word dwell in you, not political discord. Let the word dwell in you richly. That means that when you think about the word of God, you know how to refer to what the word says in every circumstance and situation. There's a word that speaks to it. What's dominating your mind? What's dominating your life? What's permeating through you? What are you allowing to happen? He said, teaching and admonishing one another. In other words, when the word dwells in you, you're supposed to be sowing that word, teaching that word, speaking that word. What are you speaking? Is it consistent with the old man and devaluing yourself, or consistent with the new man? Now look at this. This is why we sang a second ago. When the word dwells in you, you also sing with psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, thankful in your heart to God. You can't just have, I'm not going to tell you what music to listen to, what movies and stuff to watch. But if you let the wrong thing in all the time, you go, when you go through your first heartbreak, you're going to be crying off sad songs. You ain't going to have hymns. I can't breathe without you. Can't live without you. You're just going to be lost. I know. I'm just like everybody else. Sometimes you want a good song to cry on. But you got to go, get some godly music. Don't act like popular music has anything to do with God. What's on your radio? What's on your playlist? Can we put your playlist up here? Let's do that. We should have people just sitting in their playlist. Now, if you're ashamed of your playlist, probably it should change. And we will move on in the message now. Verse 17. Now, when I'm saying that, it's not to condemn you. It's because you got to let the right thing dwell in you and not devalue your currency. Verse 17. In whatever you do, this is the summary. In whatever you do, in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God and Father. Can what you do, James Lowe, can Jesus be attached to it? Or is there some things I can't attach Jesus to? And if I can't attach him to it, that means it's the old man. And I got to get away from it. You see, we need to get the right outfit on. The right outfit. Get you some coordination. Get the right outfit, you'll get the right outcome. You get the right outcome, you'll get the right relationship. Right outfit, right outcome, right relationship. It's just right. That's what we have. Why did I dead end to relationship? Because this very text now takes us to... Can't see. Right relationship. I'm just going to read this whole little. Well, would you read it? Get me verse 18, 19, and 20 to 22. Ready? Read. Relationships and their boundaries are established by God when you're in the new man. The old man tells you, I ain't submitting to nobody. You can tell me what to do. We equal in here. You may be equally loved, equally respected, equally capable, but God says in the context of marriage, he wants you to willingly yield control to another. It's an attitude, it's a disposition. He didn't tell you to obey your husband, but to submit to them. This is what he wants. And therefore it's not a bad thing. He didn't say submit if they real smart either. When I was doing my premarital counseling, the guy said, even if you're a dumb head, still a head. Doesn't mean, women, that you are getting that God won't allow you to go through the maturation process as that man is becoming who he's supposed to be. He'll still leave the structure. But in the new man, we surrender. Doesn't mean it's all together. Then husbands. But I used to think that oh yeah, you know, submission is not bad, because it's not obedience, it's submission, it's an attitude of disposition. But men, he tells you to love your wife like Christ loved the church and gave himself for her. You gotta give up everything for her. Your dream don't come before her. Your work don't come before her. Your preference don't come before her. You're laying it down for her. That's why she willingly gives in to you. My man, give me everything. But if the world points to God's way and condemns it and makes it feel wrong, and you embrace the world's ideology versus God's ideology, you don't get the blessings that come with embracing what God wanted to establish, the relationship. You're supposed to see that word. It said, children, obey your parents. They ain't tell you to submit. It ain't about your attitude. You just got to do what they say. But it's not without limits. Let me go back to the husband and wife. It's got limits. You don't submit to foolishness. You don't submit to somebody telling you, just like Paul said, you follow me as I follow Christ. He's not asking them to just, Sarah called Abraham Lord. I'm your Lord. But act right.
Right. That's it. Make a claim, Pastor Jay. That's it.
But he tells us, children, obey your parents. But it's not a blank slate. Your mama can't tell you to do something to harm you. So don't we don't have to take it to an illogical extreme. But he tells parents, though, don't exasperate your children. The three of my children are here. I could be a little exasperated. Okay. Defend me, Jackson. Defend me. I'm not that bad. Thank you. But I think exasperation is when you put them in a situation where it's no win. They're already at a deficit. And then you push and you push and you push and then you break them and then penalize them for breaking. He wants these relationships to function, but when you put on a new man, you have compassion. You have kindness. You have all the stuff you need. Then he says, bond servants, obey your masters. And then in chapter 4, he says, masters, here's how you're supposed to treat your slaves. And I know it's difficult for us to think about, slavery, but it's legitimate slavery. The word is doulos. This is a slave. This is not like a fake thing. And I know sometimes you're thinking, how could God have a world where another human could own another human? It's a fallen world. But he teaches you how to live in that fallen world with the new man in a way that pleases him. But just because one is a slave and one is master, or one is a boss and one is a worker, if they have Christ, they have a commonality of faith, and they will still treat each other with compassion. They will still treat each other with kindness and love. And Perpetua? Remember her in the Bible? And Felicity? Was that him? The one was, it was during 202. They were both arrested for being believers in Rome. But one was the slave, Felicity, and one was the master. But their response was the same. They didn't resist. I think sometimes we can only surrender when we're in the position of perceived power. I don't have to listen to you. And I think that American mindset kind of messes us up sometimes. We the people. This is a government by the people, for the people. We the people. That might be where you are politically, but that doesn't work in the kingdom. In the kingdom, it's a theocracy. It's a king, a Lord. He said, no, don't do that. Well, if you tell me why not to do it, and I agree with why not to do it, then I won't do it. But other than that, I'm going to do what I want. Where you're going to devalue your currency and send confusion. And then the final part of that verse said, whatever you do, work heartily as for the Lord and not for man, knowing that it's from the Lord you'll receive your reward. You are serving the Lord Christ. The reason I put on the new man is because I'm only able to serve him well and not devalue my currency when I've got him on me. It just doesn't work any other way. Do you know how much of a difference that you can make in this world if you don't get caught up in the old man and you leave that old man dead? And you embrace the new man, your Christianity, you being a follower of Christ, you putting on the new man and holiness and beloved and the bond of love and letting the word dwell in you richly and letting the peace of God rule in your heart. All that stuff you put on will transform this world. It will transform the political parties that are arguing. It'll transform the presidency. We're not utilizing our position to put pressure. I'm going to say, y'all don't believe this, you have power. Yes. Holiness is power. Your holy God has power. Yes. You can change the narrative. Amen. So don't I hear believers saying, we're powerless. I'm not even going to vote because I'm powerless. I'm not even going to participate because I'm powerless. God gives you power. The new man. When you live in a new man, you're not devalued. You're so valuable. You got the most powerful currency. God wants to utilize you in the newness of life that he put on you to be transformative. So get a right outfit. You'll get a right outcome. You'll have right relationships. And relationships are people. And we need to stop fighting each other and learn to walk with each other. Stop fighting in your marriage. Stop fighting with your children. Quit fighting with your boss. Quit fighting with society. And start loving like he said, love. Stand on your feet and give Jesus praise.